Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fundamentals of Marketing, Second Edition, by Paul Baines, Sophie Whitehouse, Paolo Antonetti, and Sara Rosengren. Narrated by Dennis Kleinman. Publisher's Note: This audiobook contains references to visuals present in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. Welcome to the second edition of Fundamentals of Marketing. The aim of this book is to provide an engaging and comprehensive text that covers all of the fundamental areas of marketing knowledge in a concise manner. Our research suggests that students need a rigorous textbook offering contemporary marketing insights that is suitable for courses running over a single semester. An inspirational book able to pique curiosity and inspire the next generation of marketers to excel in this exciting and fast-moving discipline. To be able to link marketing theory to marketing practice better. And accordingly, the textbook offers several student-friendly market insight vignettes in each chapter. A book that recognizes the need to go beyond the conventional four P's and to offer extended insights on services, digital and social media marketing, to recognize the importance of ethical issues in marketing, an area given special attention in this text, with the introduction of one market insight in each chapter to deal with matters of ethics, corporate social responsibility, or sustainable marketing, and coverage of marketing in context, particularly from a European perspective. Fundamentals of Marketing starts with a look at classical marketing perspectives and contrasts these with contemporary perspectives from the services and societal schools of marketing, helping you to develop your knowledge and understanding of marketing. To recognize the importance of the service-dominant logic perspective now so prevalent in marketing, we have integrated content on services marketing into one chapter. Although there remain a large number of case and market insights throughout the book, which make use of services examples. On the Ancillary Resource Center, we also provide you with web-based research activities, abstracts from seminal papers, study guidelines, multiple-choice questions, and a flashcard glossary to help you to broaden and reinforce your own learning. We aim to provide powerful learning insights into marketing theory and practice through a series of insight features, that is, case market and research insights. Who should use this book? The main audiences for this book are as follows: undergraduate students in universities and colleges of higher and further education who are taught in English around the world. The case material and the examples within the text are global and international in scale, so that international students can benefit from the text. Postgraduate students on MBA and MSc MA courses with a strong marketing component. It is hoped that such readers will find this text useful for pre-course and background reading, particularly because of the real-life case studies presented at the beginning of each chapter, accompanied by audiovisual material presenting the solution or solutions available at the Ancillary Resource Center. Professional students studying for marketing qualifications through the Chartered Institute of Marketing, the Direct Marketing Association, and other professional training organizations and trade bodies. The extensive use of examples of marketing practice from around the world make this text relevant for those working in a marketing or commercial environment. How to use this textbook? We have tried to make your learning fun and meaningful by including a multitude of real-life cases. If there is a seminal article associated with a particular concept, try to get hold of the article through your university's online library resources and read it. Reflect on your own experience, if possible, around the concepts you are studying. Above all, recognize that you are not on your own in your learning. You have your tutor, your classmates, and us to help you to learn more about marketing. This textbook includes not only explanatory material and examples of the nature of marketing concepts, but also a holistic learning system designed to aid you as part of your university or professional course to develop your understanding through reading the text and working with the materials available in the Ancillary Resource Center. Work through the examples in the text and the review questions. Read the seminal articles that have defined a particular subdiscipline in marketing. Use the learning material on the website. This textbook aims to be reader-focused, designed to help you to learn marketing for yourself. To help your learning experience, we strongly suggest that you complete the exercises, visit the web links, and conduct the internet activities and worksheets at the end of each chapter, and other activities available at the Ancillary Resource Center to improve your understanding and your course performance. Learning such an exciting discipline as marketing should be both fun and challenging. We hope that this textbook and its online resources bring the discipline to life for you and pique your curiosity about how the marketing world works and doesn't work. Good luck with your learning and in your career. Guide to the book. This book comes equipped with a range of carefully designed learning features to help you get to grips with marketing and develop the essential knowledge and skills you'll need for your future career. Identify and review through learning outcomes. Introducing you to every chapter, learning outcomes outline the main concepts and themes that will be covered to clearly identify what you can expect to learn. These bullet-pointed lists can also be used to review your learning and effectively plan your revision. Learn and evaluate through case insights. Learn from the professionals with real-life case studies from leading marketers at organizations including Microfresh, PepsiCo, and Novartis. Discover what their businesses aim to do, what their jobs involve, and what kind of challenges they face before evaluating your own response to tackling their marketing problem. On the Ancillary Resource Center, you can find bespoke video interviews with all these professionals and gain an insight into how they ultimately resolve their marketing dilemmas. Analyze and apply through marketing insights. Contemporary and varied examples from the business world illustrate the concepts discussed in the chapter, prompting you to analyze the marketing practices and apply the marketing theory to practical examples from a huge range of companies, with accompanying questions reinforcing your learning. Research and progress through research insights. Take your learning further with the key books and journal articles highlighted in research insights to aid your research and progress your understanding of key topics. Recap and consolidate through chapter summaries. Recap the core themes and ideas of the chapter to consolidate and review your learning in these handy chapter summaries. Review and revise through review questions. Stimulating questions at the end of every chapter will review your knowledge and highlight any areas that need further revision ahead of the exam. Practice and understand through worksheet summaries. These useful summaries signpost to worksheets available for each chapter on the Ancillary Resource Center. Visit the worksheets to put your new marketing knowledge into practice and reinforce your understanding. Challenge and reflect through discussion questions. Develop your analytical and reasoning skills by challenging the theory and reflecting on key issues with the stimulating discussion questions designed to create lively debate. Look up and check through key terms and glossaries. Key terms are highlighted in blue when they first appear and are collated into glossaries at the end of each chapter, designed for you to look up terms and check your understanding of essential definitions. Guide to online resources. learninglink.oup.com/sign-in. The Ancillary Resource Center is signposted throughout the chapters and provides you with access to a superior selection of fully integrated online resources for both students and lecturers. Part 1. Understanding Customers. Part 1. Understanding Customers. 1. Marketing Principles and Society. 2. Understanding Customer Behavior. 3. Market Research and Customer Insight. Part 2. Designing and Delivering the Market Strategy. Part 3. Implementing the Marketing Mix. Part 4. Managing Marketing Relationships. Chapter 1. Marketing Principles and Society. Learning Outcomes. After reading this chapter, you will be able to define the marketing concept, explain how marketing developed over the 20th and into the 21st centuries, understand the exchange and marketing mix concepts in marketing, understand the role of the marketing department within the organization, and understand the positive contribution that marketing makes to society. Case 1.1. Alderac Water. Established in 1994 by Khalid A. Al-Mamani, Alderac Watering Bottling Plant was one of the first water bottling factories in Medina, Saudi Arabia. We speak to Abdurrahman Al-Mamani, General Manager, to find out more about how the company seeks to compete with well-known international brands. Alderac, headquartered in Medina, Saudi Arabia, distributes its natural mineral water products throughout the kingdom and particularly in Medina, Makkah, and Yanbu. It is one of the biggest factories in the Middle East and a member of one of the oldest and largest family-owned businesses in Saudi Arabia. The company produces purified drinking water in different bottle sizes and capacities, from 250 milliliters to 5-gallon containers, and was the first water company in Saudi Arabia to join the International Bottled Water Association. The water produced by Alderac contains a good percentage of fluoride, is derived from natural water borewells, and is purified by ozone. In 2015, sales of the company's 250-milliliter, 375-milliliter, and 600-milliliter products were increasing strongly on 2014 sales, but falling slightly in the 2-litre, 1-gallon, 5-litre and 5-gallon bottle categories. The 5-gallon refill category, however, saw a slight gain. The future looks bright for bottled water in the kingdom, with population growth expected at 20% per year until 2019, growing retail infrastructure and an increasing number of bakala, small independent stores. Alderac's customers are mostly hypermarkets, supermarkets, and medium and small stores that distribute or sell bottled water to consumers, restaurants, fast food stores, canteens, hospitals, households, etc. Other customers include catering companies, hotels, airport retail outlets, and corporate offices. Often such customers are looking for price discounts, longer terms of payment, and even coolers in which to store the water. Distributors decide to buy bottled drinking water from the factory based on which products are available in time and can steadily be supplied to customers' volume requirements and the terms of deals and consignments, including beneficial payment terms. Of particular importance to customers is their ability to buy all of the products they need from one location. Because there are more than 30 water distributors in Medina, many customers base their decision on the price they pay. To promote awareness of the brand, Alderac recommends that customers display the product prominently in their stores, in potential customers' line of sight, and Alderac offers volume discounts to its largest distributors accordingly. In addition, it supports the community by giving free water to charities and discounted water to mosques and other religious places. Nevertheless, more recently, some large hotels and stores have started to purchase only premium water from companies selling international brands, such as Evian, Nestle, and Aquafina, making it hard for Alderac to compete with them. These big brands are competing by trying to dominate the supply chain system. For example, Aquafina, owned by PepsiCo, is pushing its water product alongside other products such as Pepsi-Cola. When Aquafina first entered the market, PepsiCo gave away free samples of water with a Pepsi product and then pushed customers to buy the Aquafina water brand from them at the same time as buying Pepsi. Coca-Cola also competed in this way with Arwa, its water product. How should Alderac seek to differentiate itself and thereby compete against both local and international brands? Introduction. How have companies marketed their offerings to you in the past? Consider the last smartphone you bought, the music you stream, and the airlines on which you have flown. Why did you decide to purchase these offerings? Each one has been marketed to you to cater for a particular need that you have. Consider how the offering was distributed. What physical and service-based components is it made of? What societal contributions, if any, positive or negative, do these offerings make? Are other versions of these offerings available that meet your needs and the needs of society better? These are some of the questions that marketers should ask themselves when designing, developing, and delivering offerings to the customer. This chapter develops our understanding of marketing principles and marketing's impact on society by defining marketing. We consider the origins and development of marketing throughout the 20th and into the 21st centuries. The core principles of marketing, incorporating the marketing mix, the principle of marketing exchange, market orientation, relationship marketing, and service-dominant logic are all considered. We then discuss the role of marketing with organizations. Finally, we review the positive and negative impacts that marketing has on society. What is marketing? There are numerous definitions of marketing, but we present three for easy reference in Table 1.1. The Chartered Institute of Marketing, CIM, and American Marketing Association, AMA, recognize marketing as a management process and an activity, although many firms organize marketing as a discrete department rather than as a service across departments. Sheth and Sisodia, 2005. Nike, for example, uses a regional matrix organizational structure, enabling marketing to operate within and across departments, such as apparel and footwear. Brenner, 2013. What all of these definitions display is how the concept of marketing has changed over the years, from including only transactional concepts such as pricing, promotion, and distribution, to encompassing relationship concepts as well, such as the importance of customer trust, risk, commitment, and co-creation. In addition, the nature of the relationships between an organization and its customers, in its offerings and its mission, are different in not-for-profit and for-profit organizations. Nevertheless, the broad principles of how marketing is used remain the same. All definitions recognize this widened concept of the wider societal applicability of marketing. Visit the online resources and complete Internet Activity 1.1 to learn more about professional marketing associations around the world. Table 1.1. Definitions of marketing. Defining institution/author. CIM. Definition. The management process responsible for identifying, anticipating, and satisfying customer requirements profitably. Chartered Institute of Marketing, 2015, Edition 2. Defining institution/author. AMA. Definition. Marketing is the activity, set of institutions, and processes for creating, communicating, delivering, and exchanging offerings that have value for customers, clients, partners, and society at large. American Marketing Association, 2017. Defining institution/author. A French perspective. Definition. Broadly translated from Lendrevi and Levy, 2014, edition 5. Marketing is the adaptation strategy of organizations to competitive markets so that they can influence the behavior of the customer segments on which they depend through an offering whose perceived value is durably superior to that of competitors. In the commercial sector, the role of marketing is to create economic value for the company by creating value as perceived by customers. What's the difference between customers and consumers? What is the difference between a customer and a consumer? The difference is subtle but real. A customer is a buyer, a purchaser, a patron, a client, or a shopper, and therefore someone who buys from a shop, a website, a business, or, in the sharing economy, another customer, example via Airbnb or eBay. The consumer is someone who uses the offering, or eats it in the case of food. To illustrate, consider Mondelez International's Dairy Lee Dunkers, dairy food designed to be a good source of calcium, with each pack contributing at least 26% of the daily reference intake of calcium. In this case, the customer is the chief shopper, the parent or guardian, and the consumer is the child. Sometimes the customer and consumer can be the same person, for example, a woman buying cinema tickets for herself and a friend online. Market orientation. The concept of market orientation, Coley and Jaworski, 1990, lies at the heart of marketing. Developing a market orientation makes organizations more profitable in both the long and short runs, Kumar et al., 2011. In a meta-analysis of market orientation studies, Kerger et al., 2005, conclude that market orientation may be imperative for survival in service firms and the source of competitive advantage in manufacturing firms. But developing a market orientation is not the same as developing a marketing orientation. So what is the difference? A company with a marketing orientation would be a company that recognizes the importance of marketing within the organization, for example, by appointing a marketing person as chief executive officer, CEO, or to chair its board of directors or trustees in the case of a charity, or to the executive team more generally in a limited company or partnership. Developing a market orientation refers to the organization-wide generation of market intelligence pertaining to current and future customer needs, dissemination of the intelligence across the departments, and organization-wide responsiveness to it, Coley and Jaworski, 1990, edition 3. So a market orientation not only involves marketing, but also requires a focus on customer orientation, which is concerned with creating superior value by continuously developing and redeveloping offerings to meet customer needs. Competitor orientation, which requires an organization to develop an understanding of its competitor's short-term strengths and weaknesses and its own long-term capabilities and strategies. Slater Narva, 1994, and interfunctional coordination, which requires all functions of an organization to work together for long-term profit growth. A brief history of marketing. Marketing developed in a four-stage sequence as follows. 1. Production period 1890s to 1920s. The period was characterized by a focus in the firm on physical production and supply. Where demand exceeded supply, there was little competition, and the range of products was limited. This phase came after the Industrial Revolution. 2. Sales period 1920s to 50s. The second period was characterized by a focus in the firm on personal selling, supported by market research and advertising. This phase took place after the First World War. 3. Marketing period 1950s to 80s. Next came a more advanced focus in the firm on the customer's needs. This phase came after the Second World War. 4. Societal marketing period 1980s to present day. Marketing then came to be characterized by a stronger focus on social and ethical concerns in marketing in the firm and recognition that not-for-profits could also undertake marketing. This phase took place during the information revolution of the late 20th century. Enright, 2002. In the last 20 years, marketing practice has quickly evolved thanks to its increasing importance for boards of executives and the dramatic development of new technologies. Marketers have been able to focus on individual customers and gain further insights based on short feedback loops. More recently, marketing teams have become one of the key functions in many companies and have learned how to integrate with other business departments. In the meantime, the development of new digital media has created novel opportunities for marketers to learn about and interact with existing and new customers. Kumar, 2015. Marketing as a discipline has developed as a result of the influence of its practitioners, as well as developments in related disciplines, including the areas of industrial economics, psychology, sociology, and anthropology, as follows. Industrial economics influences. Our knowledge of the matching of supply and demand within industries owes much to the development of microeconomics. For instance, the economic concepts of perfect competition and the matching of supply and demand underlie the marketing concept, particularly in relation to the concepts of the price at which offerings are sold and the quantity distributed. Theories of income distribution, scale of operation, monopoly, competition, and finance all derive from economics. Bartels, 1951. Although the influence of economics over marketing is declining. Howard et al., 1991. Psychological influences. Our knowledge of consumer behavior derives principally from psychology, especially in the early days. Motivation research in relation to consumer attitudes, perceptions, motivations, and information processing. Holden and Holden, 1998. And our understanding of persuasion, consumer personality, and customer satisfaction. Bartels, 1951. Sociological influences. Knowledge of how groups of people behave derives from sociology, with insights into areas such as how people from similar gender and age groups behave, demographics, how people in different social positions within society behave, class, why we do things in the way that we do, motivation, general ways that groups behave, customs, and culture. Bartels, 1951-1959. Our understanding of what society thinks as a whole, that is, public opinion, how communications pass through opinion leaders, Katz, 1957, and how we influence people in the way that they think and to adopt our perspective, example, propaganda research, Seeley, 1945, Dube, 1948, have all informed marketing practice. Anthropological influences. Our debt to social anthropology increases as we use qualitative approaches such as ethnography, netnography, and observation in researching consumer behavior, particularly the behavior of subgroups and cultures such as tweenagers, hall girls. Market Insight 1.1. Customer Obsession at First Direct. As of 2019, consumer-centric companies are often ranked as the most successful as they manage to attract new customers while maintaining strong relationships with existing ones. It is no longer only marketing departments that are focused on customers, but the wider organization, often illustrated by the employee culture within it. The characteristics of such companies include their ability to provide personalized services and understand their customers' high expectations. Through their structure, customer-centric companies are also able to respond quickly to queries and solve the issues of unsatisfied customers in a timely manner. They also demonstrate empathy, the ability to understand customers' situations and react accordingly. Finally, these companies develop integrity and a strong sense of purpose to generate trust from their customers. This last point is particularly helpful to attract younger customers who are keen to pay more for stronger brands. This is the case at UK bank First Direct, which excels at providing financial services. In 2019, the company was ranked first among more than 300 brands in terms of customer experience by KPMG's Customer Experience Excellence Report. This is especially remarkable given that the bank does not have any physical branches and only interacts with its customers online and over the phone. The company has also been praised for its ability to solve customers' queries quickly while demonstrating empathy. To achieve such results, First Direct has successfully adapted to recent changes in how customers manage their accounts while maintaining a consistent service quality. In particular, the firm has managed to keep up with digital innovation and trends in the financial technology sector, fintech. For example, First Direct has closely worked with smaller companies to develop open banking solutions to allow third-party applications secure access to customers' accounts. First Direct also recently developed its co-creation platform, F-Design, to gather customers' feedback on some of their new ideas. 1. How can the integrity and trustworthiness of a brand help win the loyalty of existing and new customers? 2. With the rise of new digital banks such as Monzo and Starling, how can First Direct adapt its strategy to maintain its reputation as a top customer-oriented firm? 3. What other companies can you think of that would benefit from being more customer-oriented? The principal principles of marketing. Marketing involves a series of highly complex interactions between individuals, organizations, society, and government. Consequently, it is difficult to develop general principles that apply to all contexts. However, we can make at least some law-like generalizations. According to Leon and Schultz, 1980, these include the following generalizations. 1. Advertising has a direct and positive influence on total industry market sales. All advertising done at industry level serves to increase sales within that industry. 2. Selective advertising has a direct and positive influence on individual company brand sales. Advertising undertaken by a company tends to increase the sales of the particular brand for which it was spent. 3. The elasticity of selective advertising on company brand sales is low, inelastic. For frequently purchased goods, advertising has only a very limited effect in raising sales. 4. Increasing store shelf space, display, has a positive impact on sales of non-staple grocery items, such as products bought on impulse, example, ice cream, chocolate bars, rather than those that are planned purchases, which are less important but perhaps more luxurious types of goods, example, desserts, certain types of cooking sauces. For impulse goods, the more shelf space you give an item, the more likely you are to sell it. 5. Distribution defined by the number of outlets has a positive influence on company sales, market share. Setting up more retail locations has a positive influence on sales. Marketing as exchange. Marketing is a two-way exchange process. It is not solely about the marketing organization doing the work. The customer also inputs, sometimes extensively. Customers specify how we might satisfy their needs, because marketers cannot read their minds. Customers must then pay for the offering. In the mid-1970s, there was an increasing belief that marketing centered on the exchange process between buyers and sellers and associated supply chain intermediaries. Exchange relationships were seen to be economic, example, a consumer buying groceries, and social, example, the service provided by the police on behalf of society paid for by government. Baggozi, 1975. There are numerous types of buyer-seller exchange in marketing. Figure 1.1 illustrates some examples of two-way, dyadic exchanges and the resources exchanged in these interactions. By understanding how exchanges take place between members of the supply chain, we can determine where to add value to the customer experience. Figure 1.1. Examples of marketing exchange processes. A. The police keep public order, including protection from crime and terrorism. The public provide public funds and cooperation. B. A retailer provides goods and customer service. A customer provides money, retail price for goods. C. The manufacturer provides goods, credit facilities, return facilities, distribution arrangements, and other services. A retailer provides money, wholesale price for goods. D. A charity provides provision of services to those in need, typically third parties. Donors provide funds and volunteering. E. A theatre provides escapism, education, and entertainment. A customer provides money, retail price for seats. F. A manufacturer provides offering, credit facilities, return facilities, distribution arrangements, and other services. A customer provides money, price for offering. The marketing mix and the four P's. Neil Borden originally developed the concept of marketing mix in his teaching at Harvard University in the 1950s. His idea was that marketing managers were mixers of ingredients, that is, chefs who concoct a unique marketing recipe to fit the requirements of customers' needs at any particular time. He composed a 12-item list of elements that the manufacturer should consider when developing marketing mix policies and procedures. Borden, 1964. This list was simplified and amended by Eugene McCarthy, 1960, to become the more memorable but rigid four P's. That is, product, for example, the offering and how it meets customers' needs, its packaging, and its labeling. Place, distribution, for example, the way in which the offering meets customers' needs. Price, for example, the cost to the customer and the cost plus profit to the seller. And promotion, for example, how the offering's benefits and features are conveyed to the potential buyer. The intention was to create a simpler framework around which managers could develop their planning. Although there was recognition that all of these elements might be interlinked, example, promotion based on the price paid by the consumer, such interplay between these mixed components was not taken into account by McCarthy's framework. Research Insight 1.1. To take your learning further, you might wish to read this influential paper. Borden, N.H., 1964. The Concept of the Marketing Mix. Journal of Advertising Research, Volume 4, pages 2-7. This easy-to-read early article explains how marketing managers act as mixers of ingredients when developing marketing programs. The marketing mix, popularized as the four P's, remains popular today, although the advent of relationship marketing challenged the impersonal notion of marketers as manipulators of marketing policies and focused more on the need to develop long-term interpersonal relationships with customers. Visit the online resources to read the abstract and access the full paper. The extended marketing mix. It might seem that what is exchanged in a service context, such as purchasing a holiday, is different from what is exchanged in a goods context, such as buying a car. Two American scholars, Booms and Bittner, 1981, suggested an extension to the original model and incorporated a further three P's into the marketing mix to reflect the need to market services differently as follows. Physical evidence. The aim here is to emphasize that the tangible components of services are strategically important. Potential university students, for example, might assess whether or not they want to attend a university and a particular course by requesting a copy of brochures or by visiting the campus to assess the service scape for themselves. Process. This aims to emphasize the importance of the service delivery. When processes are standardized, it is easier to manage customer expectations. DHL International GmbH. The German International Express, Transport and Air Freight Company is a master at producing a standardized menu of service options, such as track and trace delivery services, which are remarkably consistent around the world. People. This emphasizes the importance of customer service personnel, sometimes experts and often professionals interacting with the customer. How they interact with customers and how satisfied customers are as a result of their experiences is of strategic importance. For example, McKinsey & Company prides itself on the quality of its more than 9,000 consultants and its 2,000 research and information specialists as an integral part of its offering. McKinsey & Company, 2016. Table 1.2 applies the marketing mix for the airline industry. Table 1.2, the marketing mix, the airline industry. Marketing aspect, basic customer need, airline industry, safe long and short-haul transportation, domestic and international. Marketing aspect, target market, airline industry. Mass consumer market, economy class, the discerning traveler, economy plus, business people, business class, and high net worth individuals, HNWIs, first class. Marketing aspect, offering, airline industry. Typically differentiated based on class of passenger, with seat size increasing, check-in and boarding times reducing, quality of food increasing, and levels of ancillary services, example limousine service, increasing as we move from economy through business to first class. Some carriers focus on no-frills basic services, example EasyJet, Ryanair, Air Asia. Marketing aspect, price, airline industry. Substantial difference depending on class of service, type of carrier, and purchasing approach. Example, cheaper via internet. Marketing aspect, principal promotional tools, airline industry. 1. The internet. 2. Press, magazine and radio advertising. 3. Billboards. Marketing aspect, distribution, airline industry. Increasingly purchased via mobile apps and the internet, including third-party brokerages such as Expedia, as well as, to a lesser degree in many countries, through physical travel agents. Marketing aspect, process, airline industry. Self-service via mobile phone or internet, or aided by travel agent in retail location. Travel options increasingly customized to the customer's needs, including size of baggage allowance, class of travel, and increasing availability of alternative and multi-center locations. Customer and organizational use of social media to air and resolve problems now very important. Marketing aspect, physical evidence, airline industry. Airline loyalty cards and souvenirs, in-flight magazines, in-flight entertainment services, food and snack meals, grooming and toiletry products provided. On some flights, depending on class purchased, suites, bars and shower facilities offered. Marketing aspect, people, airline industry. Combination of check-in staff, customer service personnel, baggage handlers and cabin crew pilot teams, all of whom interface with the customer or their belongings at different points in the experience. Relationship marketing, service-dominant logic and co-creation. If marketing is about exchange, should marketing not also be concerned with relationships between those parties that are exchanging value? This was the principal idea behind the development of relationship marketing in the 1990s. The concept spawned further evolution of marketing's conceptual foundations. There was a shift from the need to engage in transactions towards the need to develop long-term customer relationships, including relationships with other stakeholders. Christopher et al., 2002, including suppliers, potential employees, recruiters, referral markets. For example, retail banks partly relying on professional services organizations, including estate agents, for mortgage referrals. Influence markets, such as regulatory authorities, politicians, and civil servants. And internal markets, for example, existing employees. Companies employing a relationship marketing approach stressed customer retention over customer acquisition. Customer retention is an important activity in marketing, with research demonstrating that when a company retains loyal customers, it is more likely to be profitable compared with competitors who do not, because loyal customers will increase their purchases over time, are cheaper targets for promotion, who are happy with their relationship with a company are happy to refer it to others, and are often prepared to pay a small price premium. Reichheld and Sasser, 1990. More recently, there's been a realization that marketing needed to shift beyond a goods-based paradigm towards a service-dominant logic. Vargo and Lush, 2004. This new marketing paradigm sees service as the fundamental basis of exchange. In that sense, for physical goods offerings, the good is simply the distribution mechanism. To understand this concept better, consider the difference between purchasing a music CD from a shop such as HMV versus streaming a music file from Spotify's subscription service. The knowledge and technologies embedded in the offering by the company to meet customers' needs are the source of competitive advantage. Because offerings are inherently service-based, customers become co-creators of the service experience. Therefore, in the end, the ultimate value in use of the offering is specified by the customer, often after the sale has taken place. According to Prahalad and Ramaswamy, 2004A, 2004B, organizations should use co-creation to differentiate their offerings, given that value is tied up inside the customer's experience with the organization. The co-creation experience is about joint creation of value, in which customers take part in an active dialogue and co-construct personalized experiences. Therefore, organizations wishing to enhance customer input to co-creation should map supplier and customer processes to identify how to design their services accordingly. Paine et al., 2008. The process of co-creation, therefore, potentially shifts value creation from value in exchange at the point of purchase to value in use after purchase. Grönroos and Voimer, 2013. For example, airplane manufacturer Boeing incorporated feedback from both airline companies and passengers into its Dreamliner plane design before final production. Research Insight 1.2. To take your learning further, you might wish to read this influential paper, Vargo SL and Lush RF, 2008. Service-Dominant Logic, Continuing the Evolution, Journal of the Academy of Marketing Science, Volume 36, Issue 1, pages 1 to 10. This article builds on and updates the author's original groundbreaking article, Vargo and Lush, 2004, which redefined how marketers should think about offerings, arguing that it was necessary to move beyond the idea of tangible versus intangible goods, embedded value and transactions, and other outmoded concepts derived from economics towards the notion of intangible resources and the co-creation of value and relationships. The article asserts that service is the fundamental basis of all exchanges in marketing, and that value is always determined by the beneficiary. Visit the online resources to read the abstract and access the full paper. Market Insight 1.2. Servitization at Rolls-Royce. Rolls-Royce is a global provider of integrated power systems and services to the civil and defense aerospace, marine, nuclear, and power systems markets. However, Rolls-Royce PLC, which no longer owns the Rolls-Royce motorcar brand, has completely redefined itself since the early 1970s, when it was nationalized by the then conservative government after running into financial problems. In 2018, it had underlying revenues of £15.1 billion, up 10% on 2017, with an order book of £63.1 billion. Product service revenue ratios in 2014 were 42-58 in civil aerospace, 46-54 in defense, and 67-33 in power systems. By comparison, aftermarket sales, as they were then known, were only 20% of the civil aerospace division's revenues in 1981. Since then, Rolls-Royce has transformed its business model from selling engines and aftercare to ensure that the engines work properly and are maintained, to selling its customers power by the hour, recognizing that it is not in the engine manufacturing business, rather it is in the power generation integrated solutions business. In the civil aerospace sector, Rolls-Royce sells its engines with Total Care. With Total Care, a customer enters into an overall agreement with Rolls-Royce that provides visibility of cost and a guarantee of product reliability. It was first introduced in the 1990s and charges airline customers based on the total number of hours flown. By collecting data from aircraft engines in flight worldwide on a continuous basis, Rolls-Royce maintains those engines better, predicts engine failures, optimizes engine maintenance programs, and improves future engine design. 1. Why do you think Rolls-Royce has been so successful in selling the service concept? 2. Check out the websites of Rolls-Royce's competitors, GE and Safran. How do their service offerings in their civil aerospace divisions compare with that of Rolls-Royce? 3. Can all manufacturers' products be servitized, do you think? What do marketers do? The marketing department within organizations has become increasingly important as customers' buying behaviors are fast changing and their expectations have skyrocketed. IBM Watson Marketing 2018. Today, most firms embrace a customer-oriented approach and no longer only focus on selling their products and services. Instead, they aim to build trust and long-term relationships with new and existing customers. This trend has led marketers to exert a growing influence on other functions within the organization as they sit at the interface with customers. Measuring the impact of the marketing activities on a firm's financial performance is crucial to assess their importance. However, it can be difficult to quantify it as marketers do not necessarily generate short-term profit, unlike sales and operations teams. Feng et al. 2015. For example, strengthening brand image via sponsorship may not result in immediate profit in the short term, but may positively impact the company in the long term. Nonetheless, studies have demonstrated the importance of the marketing department on the financial performance of the company. Example, Homburg et al. 2015. Within organizations, two opposed internal structures are considered. Functional marketing organization, in which a dedicated group of experts are in charge of all marketing activities, and marketing process organization, in which the marketing activities are shared between all functions, Moorman and Rust, 1999. In practice, marketing organizations are structured somewhere between these two approaches. A dedicated team is usually in charge of the marketing-related activities, but collaborates extensively with other departments. The marketing team should maintain clear ownership of the customer activities so that market knowledge is not thinly dispersed between too many departments. Verhoef and Lieflang, 2009. The UK's CIM developed a framework of marketing abilities to guide the skills and behaviors of professional marketers at different levels of proficiency and seniority. CIM 2019. It is important to stress that marketing is present in all aspects of an organization, since all departments have some role to play with respect to creating, delivering, and satisfying customers. For example, members of the procurement department buying components for a new product or service must purchase those components of a specific quality and at a certain cost that will meet customer needs. In fact, we can go through all departments of a company and find that in each department there is a marketing role to be played to some extent. In other words, marketing is distributed throughout the organization and all employees can be considered to be part-time marketers. Gummerson, 1990. Interface with customers. In an increasing customer-centric context, the marketing function ensures three connections between the firm and its customers. Customer product, this connection is about informing customers about a product or service. Customer service delivery. This connection guarantees that customers are satisfied with the services delivered by the firm, measuring their satisfaction and adapting future delivery accordingly. And customer financial accountability. This is about measuring the impact of customer satisfaction and the firm's revenues. Moorman and Rust, 1999. Recent technological development has also contributed to the timely and continuous measuring of customer satisfaction that can be acted on quickly and effectively. This process, referred to as marketing agility, enables firms to adapt their offering to customer feedback and reduce delivery time. IBM Watson Marketing, 2018. Influence within the firm. The marketing department advocates the customer orientation to the rest of the firm, focusing on long-term strategic goals rather than short-term priorities. It is also in charge of communicating market information within the firm and orchestrating the actions that can impact customers across all other functions. Verhoef and Lieflang, 2009. In large organizations, the CMO, Chief Marketing Officer, is responsible for all marketing activities and promotes them to the Board of Executives. The CMO's impact on the performance of a firm can be as high as 15%. German et al., 2015. To provide a consistent message to customers, the CMO also ensures alignment of the mission statement and values between the different functions of the firm, from the executives to the marketing and sales teams. Ellett, 2015. In recent years, some companies have replaced their CMO with a CCO, Chief Customer Officer, to emphasize their customer-centric approach. Even if this new role is often not clearly outlined, the CCO is in charge of the interface between the firm and its customers, defining a customer strategy and executing it. Rust et al., 2009. Innovation and marketing. The marketing department plays a crucial role in the development of new propositions. By collaborating with employees in the research and development R&D department, marketers generate innovations and provide their market and customer knowledge to shape new offerings and ensure that they meet customer demand. The role of marketers is especially important since the effectiveness of product innovation is shaped by three main factors: market knowledge, the information on customers and competitors, both breadth, the diversity of information, and depth, the complexity of information, should be considered. Cross-functional collaboration. The collaboration between different functions, especially marketing and R&D, to generate new offerings. And knowledge integration mechanisms. The process of collecting and analyzing market insights and sharing it across multiple functions. De Luca and Etwahini Jima, 2007. Research Insight 1.3. To take your learning further, you might wish to read this influential paper. De Luca L.M. and Etwahini Jamar K., 2007, Market Knowledge Dimensions and Cross-Functional Collaboration, Examining the Different Routes to Product Innovation Performance, Journal of Marketing, Volume 71, Issue 1, pages 95-112. In this seminal article, the authors describe the factors that affect product innovation from a marketing perspective. They list market knowledge, cross-functional collaboration, and knowledge integration mechanisms as the three predictors of the performance of new offerings. From a sample of 750 Chinese technology companies, they conclude that market knowledge breadth is the most important factor for predicting successful innovations. Visit the online resources to read the abstract and access the full paper. Marketing's positive impact on society. Marketing impacts both positively and negatively on society. Wilkie and Moore, 1999, described the complexities of what they call the aggregate marketing system. The distributive capacity of the aggregate marketing system is amazing, especially when we consider that there were around 517 million people in the European Union in 2018, each of whom is brought his or her own unique mixture of breakfast offerings each morning. CIA 2019. Broadly, the aggregate marketing system in most countries works well. We are not all starving, and we do not have to ration our food to preserve the amount we eat. There are parts of certain countries in Africa, North Korea, and parts of China where people are dying of hunger. But these countries often experience imperfections in supply and demand because of political, such as war, dictatorship, famine, and environmental circumstances, such as drought. Thus, marketing plays an important role in developing and transforming society. Some of the world's most important inventions have come to us through the aggregate marketing system. Consider how some of the offerings outlined in Table 1.3 have affected your own life. What would we do without these inventions today? We enjoy them because innovative individuals and companies made them available to us. Table 1.3. Some modern consumer products and their dates of invention. Consumer product: breakfast cereals. Product attribute: cereals that, when added to milk, can provide a healthy meal. Consumer need: quick and easy to prepare foodstuff that was rapidly adopted as a breakfast meal. Inventors/pioneers: W.K. Kellogg Foundation, United States. Year of invention: 1906. Consumer product: television. Product attribute: transmission of moving images. Consumer need: information, entertainment, and education. Inventors/pioneers: Baird Television Development Company, UK, Telefunken, Germany. Year of invention: 1929 to 1932. Consumer product: carton. Product attribute: cardboard liquid storage device. Consumer need: allows liquid foodstuffs to be stored, packaged, and distributed in an environmentally friendly way. Inventors/pioneers: Tetra Pak, Sweden. Year of invention: 1951. Consumer product: artificial sweeteners. Product attribute: xylitol, as the sweetener is known, used to sweeten food products such as sugar-free chewing gum and toothpastes. Consumer need: sweetens food products without damaging teeth. Inventors/pioneers: Kulta, Finland. Year of invention: 1969. Consumer product: mobile phone. Product attribute: handheld device for making telephone calls while in motion. Consumer need: ability to stay in telephone contact with others regardless of location. Inventors/pioneers: NTT Japan. Year of invention: 1979. Consumer product: personal computer. Product attribute: machine allowing users to play electronic games, perform calculations, and write word process documents and other applications. Consumer need: time-saving device simplifying complex writing arithmetic tasks, offering recreational possibilities, example game playing. Inventors/pioneers: IBM United States. Year of invention: 1980. The named companies are not always the inventors per se. They often acquired the patents from the inventor and so were licensed to produce and distribute the invention. Sources: various, including inventors.about.com and manufacturers' websites. The aggregate marketing system also impedes offerings that do not meet consumer needs. Hence, it provides a number of benefits to society, including the following: Wilkie and Moore, 1999. The promotion and delivery of desired offerings. The provision of a forum for market learning, that is, we can see what does and what does not get through the system. The stimulation of market demand. The provision of a wide scope of choice of offerings by providing a close or customized fit with consumer needs. The facilitation of purchases or acquisitions generally, for example, if no payment is made directly, as in the case of public services. Time savings and promotion of efficiency in customer requirement matching. new offerings and improvements to meet latent and unserved needs, and the pursuit of customer satisfaction for repeat purchases. Visit the online resources and complete Internet Activity 1.2 to learn more about how marketing innovation impacts upon society. Market Insight 1.3. Google, World-Changing Innovations. In 1996, Google began life as a research project, developing what became its acclaimed search engine and PageRank algorithm. Since those heady early days, Google has completely transformed society by changing the way in which we acquire information. Many of Google's other innovations have become part of people's daily lives. For example, Google Books, which has digitized millions of books so that people can preview a snippet of a book's contents prior to making purchase decisions, or Google Maps, which allows people to plan and pursue their travel routes on foot or by car, bicycle, or public transport, whenever they have a mobile internet connection. So what is the company's secret to achieving innovation success? Part of the answer is that Google has been renowned for its policy of allowing its engineers and developers to spend 20% of their time on independent projects. 20% of time projects have included Gmail, Google News, and AdSense. Its corporate principle for innovation is referred to as the 8 pillars of innovation. These highlight important ideas for building innovation capacity, such as having a mission, thinking big, but starting small, striving for continual innovation, and being willing to fail. But Google's innovation success does not derive only from corporate policy. It is generated from an understanding of what customers and users are thinking. Google champions and capitalizes on ideas gained from customer insight. Customers or users are deemed as an open source for creativity and inspiration on the basis of which Google can create something novel. Google X, a semi-secret R&D facility, manifests Google's innovation practices. Google X's mandate is to invent new technologies or ways of fixing anything that presents a significant problem for humankind. Since its inception in 2010, Google X has been home to many avant-garde innovations, including the self-driving car initiative and internet-connected spectacles known as Google Glass, among other incredible projects. 1. Why are the innovations created by companies such as Google so important to local communities and society in general? 2. Do futuristic innovations such as Google Glass and the self-driving car really help society, or do they simply generate profit for the developers? 3. What other companies are you aware of that have had a big impact on society? With what offerings? Sources: Bort 2014, D'Onofrio 2015, George 2015, McDonald 2015, Scott 2015, Tate 2015. This market insight was kindly contributed by Dr. Ning Baines, De Montfort University, UK. Chapter summary. To consolidate your learning, the key points from this chapter are summarized below. Define the marketing concept. Marketing is the process by which organizations anticipate and satisfy their customers' needs to both parties' benefit. It involves mutual exchange. Over the last 25 years, the marketing concept has changed to recognize the importance of long-term customer relationships to organizations. Explain how marketing has developed over the 20th and into the 21st centuries. There have been four main phases in the history of marketing: the production era, the sales era, the marketing era, and the societal marketing era. Understand the exchange and marketing mix concepts in marketing. The concept of exchange is important, empathizing with customers to understand what they want and determining how sellers seek to provide what buyers want is a central concept in marketing. The marketing mix comprises product, the offering, place, the distribution mechanism, price, the value placed on the offering, and promotion, how the company communicates that value. For services marketing, because of the intangible nature of the service, marketers consider an extra three P's, including physical evidence, how cues are developed for customers to recognize quality, process, how the experience is designed to meet customers' needs, and people, the training and development of those delivering the customer experience. Understand the role of the marketing department within the organization. The marketing department within the firm is in charge of the interface with customers and advocates a customer-oriented approach to other functions. Marketing activities are not limited to the marketing department and are also undertaken by other functions. It is crucial that marketing teams collaborate with other parts of the organization, particularly for generating new offerings. Understand the positive contribution that marketing makes to society. The aggregate marketing system delivers to us a wide array of offerings, either directly or indirectly, through business markets to serve our wants and needs. There is much that is positive about the aggregate marketing system, and it has served to improve the standard of living for many people around the world. Review questions. 1. How do we define the marketing concept? 2. How do the AMA and the CIM definitions of marketing differ? 3. What is the difference between customers and consumers? 4. How has marketing developed historically? 5. What is the marketing mix? 6. What are the responsibilities of the marketing department? 7. What are the roles of the CMO? 8. What is marketing agility? 9. How can marketing teams contribute to innovation? 10. What positive contributions does marketing make to society? Worksheet summary. To apply the knowledge you have gained from this chapter and to test your understanding, visit the online resources and complete Worksheet 1.1. Discussion questions. 1. Having read Case Insight 1.1 at the beginning of this chapter, how would you advise Alderac as it attempts to differentiate itself from national and international brands? 2. Read the section The Marketing Mix and the 4 P's and draw up marketing mixes for the following organizations and their target customers. A. Streaming video company Netflix and its audiences. B. A luxury hotel group and its wealthy clientele. C. Pharmacies such as Boots UK Limited, Sweden's Apoteket AB, Holland's Ethos BV, and their consumers. D. A company supplying glass to construction companies. 3. Select a company that transitioned to a service dominant strategy. Why do you think it was successful? 4. Research the CMO of a large company, example Unilever or Apple. What values of the brands that it represents does it communicate online? Visit the online resources and complete the multiple choice questions to assess your knowledge of this chapter. Chapter 2. Understanding Customer Behavior. Learning Outcomes. After studying this chapter, you will be able to explain the consumer product acquisition process, explain the processes involved in human perception, learning, and memory in relation to consumer choice, understand the importance of personality and motivation in consumer behavior, and set out the main processes and stages associated with organizational buying and purchasing. Case Insight 2.1. AirCall. AirCall is the cloud-based phone system of choice for modern brands with over 300 employees across its Paris and New York offices. It is a trusted provider around the world. We speak to Carly Dell, director, demand generation at Aircall to find out how it shifted its customers from buying a monthly service subscription to buying an annual one. Founded in 2014, Aircall has raised $41 million from e-founders Balderton and Nextworld Capital, Draper Esprit, and Newfund. Modern small to medium-sized enterprises, SMEs, choose Aircall to provide exceptional customer experiences by bringing value to voice. These companies believe voice is a powerful way to communicate with customers, prospects, candidates, and colleagues, and enables their teams to make genuine connections to drive business and deliver memorable brand experiences. A few of the reasons they select Aircall as a provider include its ease of use and flexibility, powerful integrations, example with Salesforce, HubSpot, Zendesk, Slack, Intercom, and proven quality. Operating the software as a service, SaaS business model, our pricing is subscription-based. Customers pay per user on a regular basis for continued use of our product. We offer two billing options, monthly and annual. Monthly prices are typically up to 40% higher than annual prices. The majority of our new customers were signing up for Aircall on a monthly subscription because it was a much smaller upfront cost and gave them more flexibility and control over commitments to regular expenses, something very important to SMEs. However, for our own business, monthly pricing meant there was less predictability on the amount of net growth we were going to see in any given month because of unpredictable churn, making forecasting difficult. Because of this, we wanted to move as many current and new customers over to annual pricing as possible to enable more predictable growth and stronger, longer-term revenue streams. Plus, as a high-growth company, it's always better to have cash up front to invest in growth. In order to accomplish this, we needed to change how we marketed our pricing structure to our prospects and customers. We wanted to increase the percentage of our customer base using an annual pricing subscription by at least 4 times. In addition, we needed to educate our prospects and customers on the benefits of being on an annual pricing plan, including up to a 40% discount on services, billing being less of a hassle, and only having to go through procurement processes once per year. The question for Aircall was how could it increase the proportion of new customers to sign up for annual contracts, and how could it persuade existing customers to shift from monthly to annual contracts when renewing their contracts? Introduction. What process did you go through when deciding which university course to study? After reading this chapter, you will understand why consumers think and behave as they do. You will also understand how organizations make purchasing decisions and that there are differences between consumer behavior and business-to-business, B2B, buying behavior. We start with the former, considering cognition, thoughts, perception, how we see things, and learning, how we memorize techniques and knowledge. These are processes that are fundamental in explaining how consumers think and learn about offerings. We also discuss personality and motivation to illustrate how these psychological concepts affect how we buy. Because marketing comes alive when it is woven into the fabric of our social lives, we consider how social class, life cycles, and lifestyles influence consumer behavior. We then examine the characteristics of organization buyer behavior, focusing on the processes that allow companies to purchase the products they need to operate successfully. Consumer proposition acquisition. The consumer proposition acquisition process consists of 6 distinct stages. The process model is useful because it highlights the importance and distinctiveness of proposition selection and re-evaluation phases in the process. In Figure 2.1, the buying process is iterative, that is, each stage can lead back to previous stages or move forward to the next. Figure 2.1, the consumer proposition acquisition process. Motive development leads to information gathering, which leads to proposition evaluation, which leads to proposition selection, which leads to acquisition/purchase, which leads to re-evaluation. Motive development. The process begins when we decide that we wish to obtain an offering. This involves the initial recognition that a problem needs solving. To solve the problem, we must first become aware of it. A consumer may decide that she needs to buy a new jacket to wear to work. For example, perhaps she has grown tired of the old one, or she thinks it is out of fashion, or decides to cheer herself up, or wants to buy for a particular occasion, such as a job interview or presentation, or wants to buy it for a whole host of other reasons. Information gathering. In the next stage, we seek alternative ways of solving our problems. Our jacket buyer might ask herself where she bought her last jacket, how much jackets typically cost, what different retail outlets stock jackets, and where those retailers are located. She might ask herself where she normally buys work clothing, online or in store, what kinds of jackets are in fashion, perhaps which retailers have sales on, which store staff treat her well if she shops in store, and what the returns policies are of various online and high street retailers. Our search for a solution may be active, an overt search, or passive. In other words, we are open to ways of solving our problem, but we're not actively looking for information to help us. Howard and Sheth, 1969. The search for information may be internal, that is, we may consider what we already know about the problem and the offerings that we might buy to solve our problem. Alternatively, it might be external, that is, when we do not know enough about our problem and so we seek advice or supplementary information. At this stage, we build our awareness by increasing our knowledge both of an offering and of the competitors making that offering available. For example, someone interested in buying makeup may seek information by watching a tutorial or a product review from Dutch makeup artist and vlogger Nikki Tutorials, who has over 12 million YouTube subscribers. Proposition evaluation. Once we have all of the information necessary to make a decision, we evaluate alternative propositions. But first, we must determine the criteria used to rank the various offerings. These might be rational, example, based on cost, or irrational, example, based on desire or intuition. The jacket buyer might ask herself which website or retail outlet is the best value for money and which is the most fashionable. Consumers are said to have an evoked set of products in mind when they come to evaluate which particular product, brand, or service they want to solve a particular problem. An evoked set for the jacket buyer might include Zara, H&M, Mango, known as MNG in some countries, ASOS or Net-a-Porter, for instance. The more affluent buyer might visit a department store such as Harrods or Selfridges in the UK, or the websites of DKNY or Gucci, for example. This stage might also be termed the consideration stage. Proposition selection. Typically, the offering that we eventually select is that which we evaluate as fitting our needs more closely. However, we might select a particular offering at some distance from where we actually buy or acquire it. For example, the jacket buyer may have checked online to make her selection, intending to go to the shop to try it on, but turns up at the retailer only to find that the jacket she wants is not available, so decides on an alternative on impulse at the point of purchase. Proposition selection is therefore a separate stage in the proposition acquisition process, distinct from proposition evaluation, because there are times when we must reevaluate what we buy or acquire because what we want is not available. For example, buying a cinema ticket for one film because the seats for another are sold out. Acquisition purchase. Once selection has taken place, different approaches to purchasing might exist. For example, our jacket buyer may make a routine purchase, a pair of sports socks. A routine purchase is a purchase made regularly. Because the purchase is regular, we do not get too involved in the decision-making process. We simply buy the offering that we bought previously unless new circumstances arise. The purchase may be specialized, conducted on a one-off or infrequent basis, for example, an evening gown for a ball or a formal work event. In this case, we may become much more involved in the decision-making process to ensure that we understand what we are buying and that we are happy it will satisfy our needs, to look classy, perhaps, and not cheap. For routine purchases, we might use debit cards or cash. For infrequent purchases, we might use a credit or store card. With infrequent purchases, the marketer might ease the pain of payment by offering credit or generous warranties. Our jacket buyer might be intending to purchase the jacket, but the store's policy on returns, that is, whether it allows this or not over what period of time, may have an impact on whether or not she actually buys a jacket from that particular shop. Re-evaluation. The theory of cognitive dissonance, Festinger, 1957, suggests that we are motivated to re-evaluate our beliefs, attitudes, opinions, or values if the position we hold on them at one time is not the same as the position we held at an earlier period, owing to some intervening event, circumstance, or action. This difference in evaluations, termed cognitive dissonance, is psychologically uncomfortable. That is, it causes anxiety. For example, we may feel foolish or regretful about a purchasing decision. Perhaps we spend too much on a night out or on a meal at a slightly too fancy restaurant. Therefore, we are motivated to reduce our anxiety by redefining our beliefs, attitudes, opinions, or values to make them consistent with our circumstances, by not going to that particular bar as often or to that particular restaurant again. We will also actively avoid situations that might increase our feeling of dissonance. To reduce dissonance, we might try to neutralize it by selectively forgetting information, minimizing the importance of an issue, decision, or act. Selectively exposing ourselves only to new information consonant with our existing view, rather than information that is not, and/or reversing a purchase decision, for instance, by taking an offering back or selling it for what it was worth. The concept of cognitive dissonance has significant application in marketing. Industrial or consumer purchasers are likely to feel cognitive dissonance if their expectations of proposition performance are not met in reality. This feeling of dissonance may be particularly acute in a high-involvement purchase, such as a car, house, holiday, or high-value investment product. We are also likely to search out information to reinforce our choice of offering. On the other hand, if we are happy with our purchase, we might decide to repurchase it, thereby displaying some degree of behavioral loyalty to a particular brand. This stage is termed the loyalty stage. If we really like our purchase, we might also encourage others to buy the brand, the so-called advocacy stage. Such advocacy is common in the user-generated content, UGC, developed online. In Figure 2.1, the buying process is iterative, that is, it occurs in steps, particularly at the re-evaluation phase of the acquisition process. This is because the re-evaluation of the offering leads us back to any or all of the previous phases in the proposition acquisition process as a result of experiencing cognitive dissonance. For example, we may have bought a games console, Xbox Series X, but not completely happy with it. Perhaps we think it has poor picture quality or sound. If it were covered under warranty, this would lead us to the acquisition phase, where a new perfect product should be provided by the retailer. If the product were delivered in perfect working order, but we simply did not enjoy using it, we might revisit the original alternatives we selected, example, a next-generation PlayStation or a Nintendo Switch, and pick one of the other alternatives, perhaps one that might offer a larger variety of games. If we were really not sure about which games console to buy after this initial purchase, we might re-evaluate the alternatives we originally selected and then decide. If we were to really dislike our original purchase, and if this were to shake our belief in what we thought was important in selecting a game's console, we might go back to the information gathering phase to get more of an idea about the offerings available. Finally, if we were extremely disappointed, we might decide that our original motive, The need to play, to relax, and to have fun can best be solved by purchasing something other than a games console, which will still meet the same need, such as membership of a sports club. Market Insight 2.1. Easy purchasing at Peugeot. Car manufacturer Peugeot, with operational headquarters in Sochaux, France, sold 81,043 new cars in the UK in 2018, taking a 3.4% share of the market, significantly behind more popular brands in the UK such as Ford, Volkswagen, Vauxhall, Mercedes-Benz, BMW, Audi, and Nissan. Market share was down 1.4% on the previous year. Worldwide PSA Peugeot Citroën, the brand's owner, saw sales increase 6.8% in 2018. In Europe, group sales rose 30.6% to 3,106,160 units. However, PSA saw a decline in other overseas markets, including China and Southeast Asia, down 34.2% to 262,583 units, the Middle East and Africa down 52.8% to 291,998 units, Latin America down 15%, while sales increased in India Pacific 1.6% to 26,479 units. Given relatively sluggish economic growth and the low rates of wage inflation in many countries, vehicle manufacturers and dealership sales personnel understand the psychological anxiety that car buyers feel when purchasing new cars, especially after the purchase. The buyer's key consideration is value for money and the feeling that they've spent their money wisely. The problem is particularly acute when customers buy new cars because new cars are considerably more expensive than second-hand cars. Given that cars lose 15 to 35% of their value in depreciation the moment they leave the showroom and up to 50% by the third year, we can see why new car buyers feel vulnerable. Of course, there are benefits. New cars look better, incorporate the latest design features, and have reduced maintenance costs. Car dealers work hard to reinforce the purchase decisions made by buyers of new cars by sending customers newsletters and offering efficient or free 3-year warranty after sales service to ensure that there are no or few maintenance problems. In many cases, new vehicles are sold with free insurance, 0% finance deals, or buy now, pay later schemes, all designed to reduce the post-purchase cognitive dissonance car buyers naturally feel after their purchase. In the UK, Peugeot sweetens the sales of selected models with its Just Add Fuel deal by offering a time-limited offer of a fixed monthly payment over 37 months, 3 years free insurance, and 3 years servicing, including warranty, car tax, and roadside assistance for eligible customers. But Skoda, Seat, Nissan, Mazda, Jeep, and Hyundai also offer finance deals on selected models. The question for Peugeot, therefore, is whether their promotion will help to turn the tide of negative sales growth in the UK and result in an increase in market share for Peugeot. 1. What else could Peugeot do to reduce the cognitive dissonance felt by its customers? 2. Do you think that cognitive dissonance would increase or decrease during an economic downturn? 3. Consider a time when you purchased something that left you feeling anxious afterwards. What were you purchasing and why did it make you feel anxious? Sources: Group PSA 2019, SMMT News 2019. Perceptions, learning, and memory. Often, consumers do not understand the messages that marketers convey, either because they have not received, comprehended, or remembered those messages, or because the messages were unclear. Consumer understanding depends on how effectively the message is transmitted and perceived. Consumers receive thousands of messages every day. Human perception, learning, and memory processes must be used to attend to, filter, and store so many messages. Perceptions. Harris, 2009, defines perception as the process of acquiring, interpreting, selecting, and organizing sensory information into a meaningful picture of the world. A fundamental aspect of perception is that it represents the perceiver's effort to organize stimuli into meaningful structures and understandings of their environment. As consumers, we are interested in certain types of offering that are relevant to us when we receive marketing messages. So, men would not usually be interested in adverts or promotional messages about female sanitary products such as tampons unless they were to want to buy them on behalf of a woman in their lives. We avoid exposure to certain messages and actively seek out others. We may also expose ourselves selectively to particular messages through the media we choose to read, such as certain newspapers, magazines, e-zines, Facebook pages, Twitter feeds, or watch, example, certain terrestrial, cable, satellite, or internet television channels. It is therefore important to determine which media channels customers use. Advertisers label this concept of representing the personal importance that a person attaches to a given communication message as involvement. This is important because it explains a person's receptivity to communications, and people can therefore be segmented into high, medium, and low involvement groups, like Alido and Dib 2008. We are interested in consumers' receptivity because we are interested in changing or altering their perceptions of particular offerings. An interesting way of displaying how people think about particular offerings uses perceptual mapping, a technique dating back to at least the early 1960s, Mindach 1961. People view champagne brands differently in the UK, for example, using brand personality keywords.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.